Hello together and welcome to my channel. Today I want to comment on a video that I've already watched a couple of times. It is called An Introduction to Capitalism by Libertarian Socialist Rants. I find that video interesting because it allows me to step into the perspective of a socialist anarchist, like a totally different perspective than mine. But at the same time, there are also a couple of assumptions or statements that really don't hold water. And so I want to go through the entire video and comment on the points that I find worth commenting on.
Capitalism, An Introduction by libcom.org. At its root, capitalism is an economic system based on three things: wage labor, working for a wage, private ownership or control of the means of production, things like factories, machinery, farms and offices, and production for exchange and profit. While some people own means of production or capital, most of us don't, and so to survive, we need to sell our ability to work in return for a wage, or else scrape by on benefits. This first group of people is the capitalist class, or bourgeoisie in Marxist jargon, and the second group is the working class, or proletariat.
Okay, so here we already have the first big problem with this way of thinking. Often in socialist arguments, they just start at the point some people own the factories and some people don't. To my mind, they never take into account how the factories came into being and how some people came to own them. It's just implicitly assumed that the people who own a lot of means of production do so because they exploited everyone else. Another problem is the fact that the term means of production is not well defined at all. This scissors here is a means of production. The computer I'm using to record this video is a means of production. This calculator is a means of production. Everything can be a means of production if you use it to produce something. And so you cannot separate the term means of production from property. Also, you cannot separate the capitalist class from the working class because everybody can own a certain amount of means of production. You can go right now and buy a couple of stocks from some company, and then you own a part of that company. So you are now a capitalist, and also, if you are working for a wage, you are a part of the working class. And if you are smart, you can just keep working and keep buying stocks from this company, and so you can work your way out of the working class and into the capitalist class. Of course, if you buy the wrong stocks and you go broke, then that's too bad for you, but that's not the fault of the system, that's the fault that you bought the wrong stocks. So also this class distinction, it just doesn't work. There is no real class distinction. At any point in time, there are a certain minority of people who own a lot of means of production, and then there is a big group of people who own almost no means of production, but it's not always the same people who are in the position of owning a lot of means of production. They keep changing. Also, this mechanism is not a fault of the capitalist system. It is actually a consequence of the Pareto principle, and it would be a big long topic for its own separate video. But just to say, these categories are not like airtight. It's not like the caste system in India, where if you are born in the upper caste, then you just are there. And if you are born in the lower caste, then you're just screwed. That's just not the way our modern society is structured.
Capitalism is based on a simple process. Money is invested to generate more money. When money functions like this, it functions as capital. For instance, when a company uses its profits to hire more staff or open new premises and so make more profit, the money here is functioning as capital.
This is just a part of the normal process of saving up labor and investing it in order to increase productivity in the future. Our whole wealth and standard of living today is basically owed to this process.
As capital increases or the economy expands, this is called capital accumulation, and it's the driving force of the economy. Those accumulating capital do so better when they can shift costs onto others. If companies can cut costs by not protecting the environment or by paying sweatshop wages, they will. So catastrophic climate change and widespread poverty are signs of the normal functioning of the system.
Cutting costs by ruining the environment is one problem that can happen under capitalism, and it needs to be addressed. How to best address this problem is certainly a topic for another video. On the other hand, poverty cannot be laid at the feet of capitalism at all. Quite the contrary, actually. As the Heritage Foundation, for example, showed, the more capitalist a country is, the richer its inhabitants are. This holds for the average as well as for the bottom 10% of a country. So capitalism does not produce poverty, it eliminates poverty. What produces poverty are stupid economic policies and violence. Military dictators, socialist party dictatorships, warlords. Violence destroys stuff and work builds stuff up. And capitalism is the most efficient way of dividing work such that everyone does the thing he is best at to maximize the economic output, which maximizes a country's wealth, and so people will be richer on average and in total.
Furthermore, for money to make more and more things have to be exchangeable for money. Thus, the tendency is for everything from everyday items to DNA sequences to carbon dioxide emissions and, crucially, our ability to work to become commodified. And it is this last point, the commodification of our creative and productive capacities, our ability to work, which holds the secret to capital accumulation. Money does not turn into more money by magic, but by the work we do every day. In a world where everything is for sale, we all need something to sell in order to buy the things we need. Those of us with nothing to sell except our ability to work have to sell this ability to those who own the factories, offices, etc.
It sounds very dramatic the way he puts it here, but actually this is the most normal thing in life. If you want something from someone, you have to give him something in return. It doesn't matter if you want money, or if you want someone to work in your sweatshop, or if you want a bread or a chicken or a house or a car, you have to give the other party something in return. That's just common sense.
And of course, the things we produce at work aren't ours. They belong to our bosses. Furthermore, because of long hours, productivity improvements, etc., we produce much more than necessary to keep us going as workers. The wages we get roughly match the cost of the products necessary to keep us alive and able to work each day, which is why, at the end of each month, our bank balance rarely looks that different to the month before.
This statement is, I'm sorry to say, just completely wrong. The wages you get are determined by supply and demand, and whether or not you have more or less money in your bank account in the end of the month than in the beginning depends on how much you spend and how much you work. If you work 60 hours a week and you only eat cereal and you live in a shared apartment, then you will have a lot more money in the end of the month than in the beginning. But if you always buy the newest iPhone and have like 10 subscriptions to stupid services you don't need, like Netflix and whatever, then you will not have more money in the end of the month than you did in the beginning. But having the newest iPhone and having a Netflix subscription is not the same as just getting as much as you need to keep living. These are like in completely different categories.
The difference between the wages we are paid and the value we create is how capital is accumulated or profit is made. This difference between the wages we're paid and the value we create is called surplus value. The extraction of surplus value by employers is the reason we view capitalism as a system based on exploitation, the exploitation of the working class.
Tell me, how could it be any other way? Suppose I have a factory, or no. Suppose you have a factory. So this factory can produce, I don't know, stuffed puppets. Now, why would you hire someone to work in your factory if in the end you had no return from it at all? You earned $0. Why would you hire someone to work in your factory if in the end you have no profit from it? Why would you even have a factory in that scenario? That just makes no sense. That's exactly the whole point of the entrepreneur. The entrepreneur is the guy who invests all his money into building a factory, or maybe it's a group of people who invest all their money into building a factory to produce stuffed puppets because they believe that they can make a profit from selling them. If they will never get a single cent back, then why should they even invest their money? Of course they wouldn't, and so then there would be no factory, and then we would still live in the Stone Ages where everybody did everything by hand.
This process is essentially the same for all wage labor, not just that in private companies. Public sector workers also face constant attacks on their wages and conditions in order to reduce costs and maximize profits across the economy as a whole.
Yes, things need to be made more efficient, and government work also should be made more efficient, though it never happens, but at least it should.
The capitalist economy also relies on the unpaid labor of women working in the home.
Again, not true. A married couple is a team, and they tackle the challenges of life together. In which way they split up their labor to tackle these challenges is no one's business but their own.
Competition. In order to accumulate capital, our boss must compete in the market with bosses of other companies. They cannot afford to ignore market forces, or they will lose ground to their rivals, lose money, go bust, get taken over, and ultimately cease to be our boss.
That's exactly why capitalism is great, because competition is a mechanism that leads to an increase of quality and a decrease of price. How do you decide which phone you want to buy? You buy the best phone for the cheapest price that fits both your budget and your desires. So?
Therefore, even the bosses aren't really in control of capitalism. Capital itself is. It's because of this that we can talk about capital as if it has agency or interests of its own. And so often, talking about capital is more precise than talking about bosses.
Yes, it's the drive of people to get ahead, to produce more output with less work, to automate everything so that they can sit at home in the evening and watch something interesting on TV, instead of working on the field 14 days an hour and only eating potatoes the whole winter and dying of an infected tooth at age 25.
Both bosses and workers, therefore, are alienated by this process, but in different ways. While from the worker's perspective, our alienation is experienced through being controlled by our boss, the boss experiences it through impersonal market forces and competition with other bosses.
This is actually really true. And this alienation is a big problem today, I believe. And it keeps getting worse because of the degree of specialization of jobs. But at the same time, we still choose it voluntarily because we feel the benefits are worth the cost. For example, there would be no smartphones and there would be no advanced medicine. And we like our smartphones and our advanced medicine so much that we are willing to slave away under this system, if you so want, in order to get them.
Because of this, bosses and politicians are powerless in the face of market forces, each needing to act in a way conducive to continued accumulation, and in any case, they do quite well out of it. They cannot act in our interest, since any concessions they grant us will help their competitors on a national or international level. For example, if a manufacturer develops new technology for making cars which doubles productivity, it can lay off half its workers, increase its profits, and reduce the price of its cars in order to undercut its competition. If another company wants to be nice to its employees and not sack people, eventually it will be driven out of business or taken over by its more ruthless competitor. So it will also have to bring in the new machinery and make the layoffs to stay competitive.
Yes, this is exactly why we went from a society where everyone was a farmer to a society where only 2 or 3% of people are farmers. And at the same time, a society where everyone is a farmer has nothing but food. Now, food is great, but today we have food plus cars plus heating plus air conditioning plus computers, cell phones, medicine, you name it. So that's the benefit of this process. But the cost is that there is a brutal competition in the workplace.
Of course, if businesses were given a completely free hand to do as they please, monopolies would soon develop and stifle competition, which would lead to the system grinding to a halt.
Again, a very popular misconception. Monopolies are not a product of a free market. There are sometimes technical monopolies. For example, Google has the best search engine, but as soon as they start overcharging their product, other competitors would just start to compete for their customers. Monopolies can only bring the market to a halt if they have the power of law and the force of the police and the military behind them. That is the true problem.
The state intervenes, therefore, to act on behalf of the long-term interests of capital as a whole. The state. The primary function of the state in capitalist society is to maintain the capitalist system and aid the accumulation of capital. As such, the state uses repressive laws and violence against the working class when we try to further our interests against capital.
I don't really understand what he means by the worker trying to further their interest against capital. Don't they also want to earn more money for the same work?
For example, bringing in anti-strike laws or sending in police or soldiers to break up strikes and demonstrations.
This is a point where I do agree, and I find it absolutely appalling to use police or military against peaceful protesters. However, there is an emphasis on the word peaceful. So as long as you do not destroy any property and do not hinder anyone from going to work if he wants to, then you can unionize and strike and protest all you want. I think that's an essential part of a democracy. For me, the police should only intervene if the protest is no longer peaceful.
The ideal type of state under capitalism at the present time is liberal democratic. However, in order to continue capital accumulation, at times different political systems are used by capital to do this. State capitalism in the USSR and fascism in Italy and Germany are two such models.
Man, I don't even know what to say about this. This is completely ridiculous. State capitalism in the USSR, the United Socialist States of Russia. If you call everything that is bad in the world capitalism, then it's no wonder that in the end you come to conclude that capitalism is bad. If you call a socialist dictatorship like Soviet Russia and fascism a form of capitalism, then I don't know what the hell you are talking about. Seriously.
Which were necessary for the authorities at the time in order to co-opt and crush powerful working class movements. Movements which threatened the very continuation of capitalism. When the excesses of bosses cause workers to fight back, alongside repression, the state occasionally intervenes to make sure business as usual resumes without disruption. For this reason, national and international laws protecting workers' rights and the environment exist.
Yes, or maybe it's just because not all capitalists and people who have risen to higher ranks of society are completely evil and hell-bent on exploiting everybody at the bottom of society. Because if that actually were the case, if you actually truly believe that, then society should look quite different than it does today. But of course you're also right that strikes and protests and workers standing up for better work conditions and higher wages do have an effect on their work conditions and wages. This is part of the competition the other way around. Not only capitalists compete against each other for the consumer, but employers also compete against each other for employees. And so if employees are sought, then employers will try to convince them to work for themselves through offering them better conditions and higher pay.
Generally, the strength and enforcement of these laws ebbs and flows in relation to the balance of power between employers and employees in any given time and place. For example, in France, where workers are more well-organized and militant, there is a maximum working week of 35 hours. In the UK, where workers are less militant, the maximum is 48 hours. And in the US, where workers are even less likely to strike, there is no maximum at all. History. Capitalism is presented as a natural system, formed a bit like mountains or landmasses by forces beyond human control, that it is an economic system ultimately resulting from human nature. However, it was not established by natural forces, but by intense and massive violence across the globe. First, in the advanced countries, enclosures drove self-sufficient peasants from communal land into the cities to work in factories.
I don't know very much about the enclosure, but from what I've read, rich and well-connected landowners used the force of the state to dispel poor peasants from commonly owned lands so that they themselves could own these lands. And so in my view, yes, this is a clear evil. I would not dispute that at all. Also, of course, the feudal system and people not being allowed to own property and basically being property of someone else is completely evil. I would agree to that 100%.
Any resistance was crushed. People who resisted the imposition of wage labor were subjected to vagabond laws and imprisonment, torture, deportation, or execution. In England, under the reign of Henry VIII alone, 72,000 people were executed for vagabondage. Later, capitalism was spread by invasion and conquest by Western imperialist powers around the globe. Whole civilizations were brutally destroyed, with communities driven from their land into waged work.
Also here, I would completely agree. Imperialism is evil. It's not okay, just because you are technologically more sophisticated, to go into another country whose people have never done you any harm and to subvert them and to force them into some societal structure that they didn't choose voluntarily, and to make them work for you or in your companies or to take away their land or their resources from them. Yes, that's evil, I agree. But that doesn't necessarily have anything to do with capitalism. That's just offensive warfare, and that's evil. Whether it's a capitalist society or a feudal society or a king, or a socialist dictatorship, or a military dictatorship, or a warlord, or a tribal group against another tribal group, or a religious whatever. Yes, it's all the same, and it's all evil.
The only countries that avoided conquest were those, like Japan, which adopted capitalism on their own in order to compete with the other imperial powers. Everywhere capitalism developed, peasants and early workers resisted, but were eventually overcome by mass terror and violence. Capitalism did not arise by a set of natural laws which stem from human nature. It was spread by the organized violence of the elite. The concept of private property, of land and means of production, might seem now like the natural state of things. However, we should remember it is a man-made concept enforced by conquest. Similarly, the existence of a class of people with nothing to sell but their labor power is not something which has always been the case. Common land shared by all was seized by force, and the dispossessed forced to work for a wage under the threat of starvation or even execution.
As I've already said, I agree that forced removal from common lands is an evil. The only thing I wanted to add here is that there is also this thing called the tragedy of the commons. And so I would argue that private ownership of land is even better than collective ownership of a common piece of land. But of course, by that I mean that the people who own the land commonly should divide this land amongst themselves and then each own a part of it privately. I don't mean to take it away from them and give it to some rich and well-connected guy who then gets even richer.
As capital expanded, it created a global working class consisting of the majority of the world's population whom it exploits but also depends on. As Karl Marx wrote, what the bourgeoisie therefore produces, above all, are its own grave diggers. The future. Capitalism has only existed as the dominant economic system on the planet for a little over 200 years. Compared to the 200,000 years of human existence, it is a momentary blip, and so it would be naive to assume that it will last forever. It is entirely reliant on us, the working class, and our labor, which it must exploit. And so it will only survive as long as we let it.
Yes, that's true. The same holds for every human institution and every human mode of organizing society. And it's not that I particularly care for the capitalist system as such, it's just the one that I happen to think is the least bad that we have tried so far. And so, in this sense, I would just hope that if we ever get rid of capitalism, that the system of societal organization that comes after it would be better. Because if you compare now to the entire history of the human species, now is a pretty nice time to live, because it could be a lot worse too. And the thing that frightens me about socialists is that they might dream of some wonderful utopia, but end up creating another horrible socialist hellhole like the 10 failed experiments we've already had. So I'm all for change as long as it goes in a better direction. But the thing is that we can't afford to be naive about this, and we can't afford to just assume that we are by definition the good guys and some other group is by definition the evil guys, because that's too simple, and whenever somebody tried to restructure society based on such a worldview, it went horribly wrong and ended up in complete slaughter and unimaginably horrible circumstances. And to everyone out there who calls themselves a socialist, I would really invite you to read the Gulag Archipelago, because I don't believe that you can read this book and not have it sincerely change the way you see the world, unless you are a complete psychopath. I just can't see how anyone can read this book and not have it affect his perception. Whew. So that's my take on this video. I hope you found it interesting. Please let me know in the comments what you think. If you like this video, be sure to hit the thumbs up button. It helps me a lot, and it would also make me happy to see that my work is appreciated. So thank you for watching. Be sure to check out my website in the description, and I hope to see you guys on another video sometime. So take care.